The name of this video is Euler and Lagrange. Suppose to look at a river where water flows in one direction, let's say from the left side to the right hand side of this river. So this is my river. And suppose to consider the water molecules which pass by a point capital P1 and another point, for example here, capital P2. Now, I'm assuming I'm Euler. So Euler, what Euler does, so the flow, of course, of the river goes in this direction here. Euler decides to sit on the sides of this river, fixed, so without moving, in an inertial I reference R frame F, IRF. So that's Euler, okay? So this is called the Eulerian or Euler frame of reference. So in the Euler frame of reference, I'm sitting on the sides of the river and I observe all points if I want. For example, let's focus on this point, capital P1. Same thing for capital P2. So I focus on that point and I forget about all the rest. And I just look at that point and I see the water molecules going by this point. Let's say eventually they may go to this other point following this path. It depends how the flow of the river goes. Okay? So I look at these water molecules. Obviously, I'm looking always at the same point in space. However, the water molecules going through are different. And obviously, this analogy will work also if the water molecules are instead the charge-free carriers, the electrons flowing in a wire. That's why we're doing this. Is this the concept of a river is very similar, in fact, to the concept of an electric current. So it's very good to understand this analogy. So I'm looking at the same point, I see different molecules. Suppose that the velocity of these molecules, which is tangent to this direction here, it's a v. So this velocity is the velocity v1, which is a vector at point capital P1 and at some time t. So this is the velocity of these particles. And what I do, I just measure this velocity for all these particles that go through the same point. So if I do so, and it so happens that in this Eulerian reference frame, or frame of reference, all these velocities v1 at point capital p1 and time t, these are so-called local properties. So this is a local property of the system, it's one of the many local properties. So if this specific local property is such that it does not change with time, so it's always the same. So in other words, if I'm Euler and I do this, this means that all the many, many water molecules which go through this point, even though the molecule is different, their velocity at that point, P1, is always the same, does not change with T. Well, in this case, we say that this local property, the system is stationary, which in this case is the river, is said to be stationary with respect to this local property, the velocity. Similarly, if I observe, this has to happen locally, so this means that it's locally stationary, okay? So it can be locally, this is locally stationary. Now I can extend this and I can observe another point, capital P2, and I do the same for all possible points everywhere in this river. So in this case here, the velocity will be tangent like this. This will be our velocity V2, a point capital P2 and time t. If this argument is true for V2, as well as for all possible Vn's, for all the possible endpoints in the river, then the system is said to be globally stationary. So this is locally, this is globally, stationary, keyword stationary. Okay. There are many local properties of a system. For example, another local property could be the density, in this case, the mass density at this point, capital P1 or T, or if you want, at any point, capital Pn and time T. And so I can have a large set of local properties if for all local properties, so if the system is such that all local properties are stationary, and this is true for each point Pn, well then the system is globally stationary for all properties. For all properties. Okay, so this is what the Euler approach allows us to do. In fact, we could follow another approach, which is the Lagrange approach. In the Lagrange approach, I actually sit, so Lagrange decides to sit on top of one of these molecules. It could be this, or it could be, it's any of these infinite molecules in the river, and actually goes with it. So it flows with the river. So at some point in time, it will be a point P1, and then this molecule will be there. So in this case, the molecule is always the same. And so it has a certain velocity V1 at this point P1. But when in the Lagrange approach, I eventually go to this point P2, then the velocity can be different. So I hope this kind of captures the importance of stationarity. It doesn't mean that velocity is the same everywhere, okay? It means that in the Euler approach, each molecule has the same velocity at a certain point, the same thing for all points, but the same molecule can have two different velocities at two different points, and it still is stationary. So it's a very subtle point. That's why I think the Lagrange approach really allows, compared to Euler, to understand this subtlety. Now, what is an interesting question which I would like you to discuss in Piazza is the following. Consider a tap in your sink where, for example, those nice taps where there's also a nice filter and net just at the end of the tap. So you open water, there is a transient, so there is a chaotic moment where, you know, if you open it too strong or too weak, it doesn't mess the water. So you open it reasonably, and you wait a couple of seconds. So what happens is that the water will start to follow down, following a shape like this, okay? So in this case, we are considering a gravitational field. This is the field we're considering here. And for example, if I look at the particles, the water particles at this cross section here, they would be characterized by a certain velocity. And if I consider the particles down here, we'll be characterized by a larger velocity because we are obviously in a gravitational field, so gravitation makes them accelerate more, and so they'll go faster down here. So in this case, okay, I have these velocities which are different in these different cross sections. Now, explain to me why the water ends up having this shape. And so in order to do so, the question which I have for you in Piazza really is, what is the quantity that is constant, that remains constant in this problem? Note that, as I said, you need to wait a little bit, so this wait time allows you to go over a transient to reach a steady or stationary condition. Same thing, steady and stationary are synonymous. So if I look at this from the Lagrange approach, I look at these water molecules, different molecules have the same velocity, same down here. Okay, of course, if I'm Lagrange, I follow these molecules, and when I follow it, when it goes down here, it changes velocity, it becomes faster. Okay, so what is the quantity which remains constant? This actually allows usually people, students, it please allow me to understand a bit better this concept of stationarity. So what is actually really stationary constant in this problem? That's the question I have for you, Katja. So to summarize this video, we introduce the Euler reference frame and the Lagrange reference frame. In the Euler, I look at particles from outside the river, let's say, and I study the properties of those particles. As time goes by, different particles go through that point, and I try to understand whether these properties are the same or not. If they're the same, if they're constant, it's stationary. If not, it's not. Lagrange would follow these particles, which means even if the system is stationary, it could be that that particle has different velocity at different points. And in order to understand that, understand this water tap kind of problem down here. That's it.